Welcome. My name is Pastor Leslie Hessel, and you have signed on or signed into Generation Impact Bible College, topic number 64 for the lectures tonight. And this is now lecture number 2 for the evening, and we are going to be touching and speaking about a topic called My Race. So before we get into it, I'd like to welcome everybody that's logging in via Facebook and all the other social media channels, and at the same time, also welcome to the local students. Great to have you guys with us. We're looking forward to a great evening of ministering the Word of God. So great anticipation and expectation here this evening. So before we get into it, let's commit this time to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll get straight into the topic. Father, we just thank you for this evening. We thank you for this opportunity to once again be able to get into your word, Father God, study your word, meditate on your word, make your word part of our lives. Father, we understand and know that the word of God planted in our hearts and spoken through our mouths is what brings change into our lives, Lord. And Father God, tonight as we meditate on this word, I pray that you make it alive. Let it land on fertile ground where it can bear forth much fruit and where people can get to know that which your word says and declares in their lives. So, Father, we look forward to a great time in your presence. Holy Spirit, we welcome you into this meeting and into this lecture. We ask you just to reveal and illuminate the Word of God to every single person that is online this evening and also in the lecture room with us. So, great. My name is Pastor Leslie Hessel, just for those that haven't heard. The topic we're covering tonight is My Race. This is Generation Impact Bible College topic number 64. So we're going to get going, and we're going to have a look at tonight, and you'll see that the topic, I think, is self-explanatory. It's called My Race, and it's based on that very well-known verse that Hebrews chapter 12 verse 1 says, "Therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily snares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us." Every single one of us, doesn't matter who we are, there's a purpose and a plan that God has set out for you and my life. You have not been created by accident to live on planet Earth in the year 2020, and that on the 2nd of November 2020, you are in watching this particular broadcast. So that's not an accident, it's not a coincidence. We don't believe in that. We believe that God directs the paths and lives of every single person, because the Bible says if we commit our ways unto Him, He'll direct our paths. So we've got no doubt that God directs absolutely every single thing about our lives when we have surrendered our lives to Him. So by faith, we accept that into our lives. We thank you. We thank the Lord that He is intimately involved and interested in everything that we do. But it's not just about me. It's about His plan, His purposes, and what He has ordained for this moment in time. And therefore, because God has purposed this time for you and me, He has also got a plan for you and I for this exact moment in time, and for tomorrow, and for the next day, and for the next day. And therefore, you and I need to get to know what that plan and what that purpose is for our lives. And as we engage that plan, we then enter into a race, because the reason it's a race is because we fight against time. In this particular, you know, any race, they time you. They're trying to try and find out how long you take from beginning to end. So that's why Paul even calls this a race, because we are in this dimension of time, and because of that, we are contending with certain things. There's a time when Jesus is coming, and because He is coming and because He's returning, there is an end to this dispensation. And because of that, you and I have to redeem the time. We have to work the time to our benefit. And because of that, we are contending with that all the time. So we're running a race, and we have to complete and try and do everything that God has planned and purposed for our lives during that time. So in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, then it does say that we are in a race, and that we need to understand that we run this race with endurance. So it means that there's going to be obstacles, there's going to be problems, there's going to be issues. There is no guarantee that absolutely everything is going to run smoothly. And therefore, we have to have the endurance to get from the beginning to the end. And to do that, it means that, you know, any athlete that's going to complete a race, he has to train. He has to get his body in fit. He's got to do all the different disciplines and things that he needs to do to be able to get to the end line, to be able to excel at that which he is starting to do. So therefore, we enter this race, and we need to know that we are running this race. Now, a couple of facts and a couple of things that you and I need to know about this race. First thing, 1 Peter 4 verse 10 says, as each one has received a gift, minister it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Each one of us, doesn't matter who we are, we have our own race. We have our own endurance. We have our own journey. We have our own goals, the own destiny, the own path. All those things are unique to you and I. My race is not going to be the same as your race. And that which I'm going to do and that which I have to do and complete the tasks that God has set before me is not going to be the same task that has been set before you. And therefore, we have to understand that because my race is unique, I cannot duplicate or copy anybody else. I have to go to God, seek from God that exact plan that He has for my life, the purposes that He has for me, the tasks that He has assigned to me. And as a good steward, I will find out what those things are. I'll embrace them. I'll obey my master and I'll follow His commands and be able to do the things that He's purposed and planned for us. So for me to be able to do that, it obviously makes logical sense that I need to know my race. I need to pursue the Holy Spirit and pursue God to find out what my specific race is. And I need to find out what God has called me to. Because the more the clarity I have on the plan that God has for my life, the more focused I can be, the more specific I can be, and the more effective I can be. So therefore, I need to pursue Him with every fiber of my being to clarify that purpose for which He has called me. Now, you know, there might be new babes in Christ that are watching tonight, and because you don't know what God has called you to yet, a good place to start is just to do whatever God has commanded you in His Word. Obviously, the Great Commission says, go into all the world, preach the gospel, and make disciples. So therefore, that is a good place to start. But that is a command that's been given to every believer. It doesn't matter who you and I are. That is the Great Commission. That is something we have to do. Now, we might have, however, a specific purpose in that. In other words, there might be specific souls that you need to reach, which I can't reach. There may be people you can get to that I can't get to. There's maybe skill, not maybe, there definitely are skills and talents that people, other people have that I don't have. And because of that, they can achieve things and do things that I cannot do. And because of that, they must know what their race is and they must go in and pursue the Holy Spirit and pursue God to find out what God has called them for as an individual. Some of you might be missionaries. Some of you might be evangelists. Some of you might be teachers. Some of you might be mechanics or tradesmen. I don't know. It's whatever God has called you to do to be able to go into places that you need to go to. Also, just a bit of clarification here. When you have got that purpose and call, within that there are normally tasks. Now, tasks have a beginning and an end. And I've encouraged many people over time to say to them, listen, if God has called you into something, like into a specific city to do a specific work, that work might have a start and end date. Okay? And you might then have to move to another city and go and do something similar there, or even maybe something totally different. Remember, we are vessels in the Master's hand. The race that we are running is sometimes a marathon, sometimes a sprint. And maybe today you're sprinting, tomorrow you marathon, the next day you might be sprinting again. You don't know, but the race that you have is unique to you. God has already equipped you with every bit of skill, training, or not training necessarily, but skill and ability and potential in you already. You have to unearth that and bring that out of you to be able to accomplish that which God has set before you. So then Christ is our motivator in this race. We look at Him. He is the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Now let me just highlight one or two things here out of Hebrews 12 verse 2. It says, looking unto Jesus. So basically talking about you and I taking our eyes and setting them on a specific direction. You and I have to set our eyes upon Jesus. We cannot set our eyes on our circumstances, on the situations, on what somebody else has done, another business model over there or another church model over here. Yes, we can glean and learn from those, but we cannot model ourselves upon them because we have to set our eyes upon Jesus and allow the Holy Spirit to talk to us and reveal to us the things that He needs us to do. Looking unto Jesus, and Jesus is the author and the finisher of our faith. Now, the terminology that has been used there, the word author, is a book. It's normally when we create a book, all right, when we write something. Somebody is the author of a book, all right? So it is a story. It could be a documentary. It could be an autobiography. It could be whatever. So the author creates that and it comes out of him. Now, your story and my story, your autobiography and my autobiography, is being written by Christ. That's why we look unto him, because he is revealing our story to us, because he's the author of that story. So we have to look at him to be able to see the book that he has already written about you and my life, because he's the author thereof. You see, at the same time, that book that he has written, that story that he has developed about you and I, not only is he going to start the thing and write chapter 1, 2, and 3, he's going to go right through the book and he's going to finish it and come right to the back of the bibliography, whatever, and finish the book and have everything to do about you all encapsulated in that book. So he is the author and he is the finisher of your race. He is already knows what it is before the foundation of this world. He already knew you. He already knew what it was about. He knew what he was going to do in your life. He knew what you were going to accomplish and what you were going to do. And you and I now become good stewards of that which God has filled into us and that which God has placed inside of us. So we have to now work and walk according to that story that Jesus has written upon us. So we focus our eyes upon him. We, like flint, tune into him, and as we do that, we receive everything that his Spirit gives unto us so that we can go forward and accomplish which has already been destined for you and I. Then he carries on, your training is run in a dry place or in a desert. Nobody saw David kill the lion and bear. Nobody sees you or your preparation or even appreciates you during your preparation. So in 1 Samuel chapter 17 and verse 36, it is written, your servant has killed both lion and bear, talking about David, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing he has defied the armies of the living God. Now, where did David kill the lion and the bear? It was in the wilderness or in the desert area where he was shepherding some sheep, and he was protecting them and looking after them. Now, in that place of preparation, because it was in that quiet place, a place where he was alone, a place where he was, it was him and Jesus. And when things challenged him, when things tackled him, when things came against him, he only had one place to run to, and that was God himself, to deliver him from that particular challenge, which was the lion and the bear. The same thing with you and I. As we prepare ourselves for this race is not necessarily in the public eye all the time. You might find that your preparation, your training is in a quiet place. Even people that prepare for major athletic events, they will be in places that are very quiet. They will be in places that are you know, secluded, put into a place where they are not necessarily watched or seen. And because of that, they prepare there. They get themselves ready for the final onslaught. Now, you and I, when we prepare, when we train, it might be in the late hours of the night, it might be in the early hours of the morning, when you spend time with the Lord, when you meditate on the Word of God, when you study the Word of God, we normally set ourselves aside and we set time aside to be able to do that. And when we do that, it's not in the public eye. It's not where people are going to watch us and see us and where people are going to appreciate us and say, oh, well done, and you know, all this kind of stuff. That ain't going to happen. So much of what we do for Christ and much of what we do for God is pretty much in isolation. It's private, it's for the individual. And because of that, you and I need to prepare ourselves for that, because sometimes the journey can be a lonely one. It could be one where you have to walk it out for yourself, by yourself. So that is what the race is sometimes all about. So then your reward is a crown in heaven and not on earth. Now, for every single one of us, doesn't matter who the believers are, the Bible teaches us that there's going to come a time that when you and I stand before Jesus, that he is going to assess the work that we've done, and that work is not going to determine whether you get into heaven or don't get into heaven. That's not the issue. But he's going to give crowns to those that have been faithful and good stewards of the things that he has commanded them to do. Now, if we look at the parable of the steward, we know that the first two stewards, got praise because they took the talents that they were given and they multiplied them and they did what they were commanded to do. The third steward, he was full of fear, fearful, and because of that, he took the talent and he hid it in the sand. And for that, he actually got a very strong rebuke, and he basically lost everything, and that which he had was given to the guy that had most, and he was increased even more. So we know and understand that there's a responsibility upon you and I as believers that we are good stewards and good custodians of the purpose and the plan and the tasks that God has placed upon us. In other words, that purpose that God has placed upon you. That's why it's important that you and I fulfill the will of God in our lives. We pursue His will for our lives so that we can accomplish that and be good stewards of what He has done. So that way we know and we can be sure that we honor Him with absolutely everything that we are. We are obedient to His instruction, to His will, to His desire, not to our own will, not to our own desire, not to our own directions and things that we want to pursue. And that's why you and I need to get to that place and understand that is what we are going to do. Now in 1 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 25 it says, "And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown." So in other words, a crown that God gives unto us is an imperishable one. You know, my personal opinion is that when that day does arrive one day and God does give us those crowns, yeah, I've got this picture in my mind that we're going to most probably just cast it before His feet in honor and respect and tribute to Him because of our love and adoration, knowing that we couldn't do it on our own anyway. It was all Him and Him working in us and through us. So, we, you know, for us to earn the crowns is not really what it's about. It's for us to accomplish that which is purpose and plan for our lives. In 2 Timothy 4, verse 7 through 8, it says, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not to me only, but also to all who have loved His appearing." Now, when we purpose our lives, when we direct our lives, it's not like a shotgun approach where we just do, you know, whatever, whenever, and however. No, it's a very specific following instructions and tasks that we believe that God has given us. So our lives become like flint. It's got direction. It's got aim. We know what we want to accomplish. We know what we want to do. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 26, "Therefore I run this, not with uncertainty. Thus I fight, not as one who beats the air." So in other words, I'm not just standing and waving my hands, trying, hoping that I'm going to hit the target. You know, it's like the picture that comes in my mind is the one where, you know, these kids will go after this thing full of sweets and whatever, and they just smacking with a blindfold and just hitting wherever, and they're hoping against hope that they're going to hit the target. It's not like that. We are very focused, very, very directed. We know exactly where we're going. We know exactly what God wants us to do. And therefore, we're not wasting time. We're not wasting energy. We're not breathing or wasting air. Then finishing your race is the goal. Okay, so in Acts chapter 20 and verse 24 it says, "But none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy and the ministry which I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of grace." So in the book of Acts it makes it very clear that the intention is to not only run the race but to be able to complete the race. So you and I need to try and get to that place where we know we've run a good race, a race that wasn't just a false start, but it was a race that started, we went through the whole thing and got to the final end. The ultimate statement is that which we're pursuing is, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Matthew 25 verse 23 says, his Lord said to him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord." So that is the words that every single believer wants to hear one day when they come before Jesus. They want to hear the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And as we come before Him, we want to be able to know that we have accomplished and we have honored Him and we've done absolutely everything that He has asked of us in our lifetime. Now, therefore, you and I pursue the will of God in our lives. We pursue that which God has set before us, that which he wants us to do. Now, the next point says, do not compare yourself with others. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 16 says, and if the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I'm not the body, is therefore not of the body? You see, an eye has a different function to an ear, has a different function to a finger, has a different function to the heart, has a different function to the lungs, etc., etc., etc. So we know in the body there's many organs, there's many parts, and because of that, each one has got its own function, its own purpose, it's been designed accordingly, but they all add together to make up the body and to allow the body to do what the body needs to do. The same thing applies to every single believer that's in the body of Christ. Your function and my function is different, therefore we cannot compare ourselves one with another, because the measure of success is not measured by, you know, wealth or assets or things that you've accumulated or any of that kind of stuff. No, the success is measured against what did God want from your life and what did you do. Okay, that's the bottom line. The bottom line is, have we honored God and have we done and accomplished that which God has set before us? If we have done that, then we have been successful. So that could be as small as giving water to somebody that's thirsty versus somebody that's got the money to put R1 million into building a building. Both of them will be successful because they honored that which God has set before them and that which God has asked them to accomplish and to do. So in God's eyes, then both these people have been successful. And I believe when we stand before him one day, they will receive the same rewards. So it's not by the size or anything like that, but whereas we as people, we tend to go by what we can see. We tend to go by what we experience. And that is not how God measures success. So therefore, we cannot compare ourselves one to another. It is a totally unfair comparison. It is something that you and I cannot do, and it's something that we should never do. So when I look at somebody, at my brother, and I see how he lives his life and does his things, I cannot compare myself. All I can do is, have I done what Jesus asked me to do? And if I've done so, I need to take peace and pleasure in that. And I do believe with all my heart that if you are truly seeking God's will in your life, that you will be fulfilled because you'll know that you've done what God has mandated and purposed for your life. You and I are gifted differently. And because we are gifted differently, if somebody is going to tell me, listen, I want you to go and paint a painting and do whatever, I'm going to fail miserably because I'm not an artist. But then you get the next person who's a graphic or a fine artist, and they've got amazing skill and they can do amazing drawings and paintings of whatever. And they will do that and they will excel at it. But God will hold them accountable because that gift is what they're going to have to use. And they, how good a steward were they of that gift? Then whatever gifting God has given me, he's going to hold me accountable for. And I need to understand that. So I can't compare my gifting and what God has given me with the next person. Now, it is obviously important that you and I develop these giftings in our lives. And we need to run according to that which God has set before us. In 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 5, the Bible says, and also if anyone competes in athletics, he's not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. So we need to understand and know that every single thing that we do in the Word of God, there are principles, there are guidelines, there are things that you and I need to adhere to. All right, and because we do that, we run the race according to that, and that is what makes us successful. Like, if you want to prosper financially, the Bible says, give and it shall be given unto you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your bosom. So we understand that God blesses giving. God, if you look at the gift that the centurion brought to God, and the way he honored God, and then Peter came and the angel appeared before Peter and told him to go to the centurion and all this kind of stuff. And in that dialogue that the angel had with Peter, with the centurion, he said that your alms came up before God as a sweet smelling sacrifice. And because of that, his giving was therefore something important. And that is one of the guidelines or rules within the Word of God. Given it shall be given unto you. If we lay hands on the sick, the Bible says they will recover. So that is a rule on the word of God. You can expect that you lay your hands on the sick, that the anointing flows from you to them, and that power that leaves your body touches their body, they will be healed and made whole. So we understand that there are things that the word of God says you and I can do and that we need to do to be able to benefit from the race that God has set before us. Now, third section, things you must have in order. Everything you need is already in you. I want to make that extremely and completely clear for you. You and I, when God made us, He already placed everything inside of us that we will ever need to be able to fulfill the purpose and the plans that He has set before us. The race that we need to run, it is already in you. It's already part of you. All you have to do is obey the Holy Spirit and develop that which is inside of you and allow it to come out and to be exposed. So the first thing we have to do, according to Luke 14, verse 28, is to determine and count the cost. It says, "For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it?" That is the first thing that you and I have to determine. God does not take pleasure in something, somebody starting something and then pulling out and not finishing it. If you and I are going to start something, we need to know what we're starting and we are in for the long haul. Now, we don't necessarily know up front what the cost is going to be, but there's a commitment that we make, that we say, "Lord, it doesn't matter what the cost is. The cost is irrelevant." And because of that, you make a commitment. It is like a vow that you make when you marry your wife, or your wife or lady marries her husband. Because when you stand before the preacher, you stand before God, you make a vow one to another that you will look after each other, you'll be there for one another in sickness and in health. You will, doesn't matter what the circumstances are, you make a commitment before God. And until death does you do your part. So that commitment, that vow that gets made, it's a lifetime commitment. I know in today's marriages, many people take those vows very lightly. But in my case, with my wife, that vow was very important to me. It was a lifetime vow. I will not leave her. I will not divorce her because I've made a vow before God. And that is what I'll do. So we'll work out whatever needs to be worked out between the two of us if necessary. The same way, when we come before God, we determine the cost. And we say, "Lord, even if it requires my life, even if it's unto death, I will pay that price if necessary." And we count the cost. So we come to a place then that once you've determined what the cost is, that's when you embrace and embark on the race that's set before you for your life. And you say, "Lord, it doesn't matter what happens, we are doing this thing." And that is the kind of commitment. So it's a vow, it's a commitment between you and God that you're not going to pull out, that you're going to do whatever is necessary to see that your race is fulfilled. And because of that, we then determine the cost. We also watch how we feed ourselves, how we build ourselves. And if I had to put it in the terms of an athlete, we look at our diet. So in 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15, it says, "Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." So you and I as individuals, then we will get into the word of God, which is our guide, our manual, the book that we learn. So we get into it and we study it with diligence. We study it, we spend time, we meditate on it, we allow it to become part of it, and then ultimately we obey it. We act on it, according to James. So once you do that, that is the moment that you'll start seeing the principles and the promises of the Word of God start working out in your life. Until you start acting on it and until you start working on it, a lot of Christians walk that walk, but they never get to the place where they act on the Word of God and start doing the Word of God in their lives. So therefore, they never see the results of the Word of God in their lives. But the minute that you and I become a doer of the Word and we start embracing the Word and we act on the Word, that is when the word starts working in our lives. And we need to listen to the Holy Spirit, to those that guide us, to those that coach us, to those that mentor us. So we look at the Holy Spirit and the fivefold ministries as our spiritual leaders. In John chapter 14 and verse 26, it reads, "But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring you to your remembrance all things that I said to you. Ephesians 4 verse 11 through 12 says, and he himself gave to some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. So we need to get into the Word of God, and we've got to make the Word of God our lives. We've got to listen to the Holy Spirit. We have to listen to the guidance of the Word of God, and we have to implement it in our lives to be successful in our race. Then each training program is specifically worked out for us as individuals. Philippians 2:12 says, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. In other words, the issues that I have to deal with, the areas in my life that I have to strengthen, the areas in my life that I have to work on, are not necessarily the same areas that you have to work on. The areas you need to work on might be totally different to mine. So therefore, God, through his word, will illuminate to us that which we need to adjust or allow him to come in through his Holy Spirit and work in our lives. I don't believe that we always need to work on it personally, although that will be beneficial sometimes. But most of the time, we can embrace the Holy Spirit and pray and say, Holy Spirit, help me to deal with this circumstance, to deal with this situation. And he will do that through the grace of God. Know that many will not know your capability as you have overcome things out of sight. Matthew chapter 13, verse 55 through 58 says, is this not the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary? And his brothers James, Joseph, Moses, Simon and Judas? And his sisters, are they not all with us? Where then did this man get all these things? So they were offended at him. But Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his own country and in his own house. Now he did not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. So people that are very close to you very often will not recognize that which God has placed inside of you, because they become familiar with you. They know your weaknesses. They know your failures. They know all the things that they know that where you messed up. They know where to press your buttons. And because of that, they will not always receive from you. But we know that if we allow the Holy Spirit to work in us and work through us, he will do everything and then release the capabilities in our life that needs to be done. Train in and out of season. 2 Timothy 4 verse 2 says, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching. All I can do is encourage you in that point and say to you, listen, you need to be ready for every challenge, every task, every thing that needs to happen in your life quickly, all right? You and I cannot waste time. We cannot go back and have to prepare and get ready. You need to be ready. Even in the parable of the 10 virgins, 5 were ready, 5 were not. We need to be ready. We need to be ready all the time. We need to study to show ourselves approved. We need to spend time in God's word. We need to spend time studying from his word. We need to allow his word into our lives and to do the things that we need to do. Now, the Bible gives me two examples of people that finished their races and they were able to move on and go to be with Jesus. The first one is Christ himself. In John chapter 17, verse 4, it says, I have glorified you on earth, talking to the Father. I have finished the work which you have given me to do. John chapter 19, and verse 30, says, when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. So Jesus had accomplished and done everything that he was supposed to do that God required from him within the 3 years of ministry after he started. And because of that, he was able to come to a place where he had done what needed to be done, and he was ready to move on to be with Christ. To be with the Father, Paul is another example. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7, it says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I've kept the faith. So Paul as well got to a place where he knew that everything that God required of him, his task, his race, he had finished it and he was ready to go home to be with Christ. So the same thing with you and I. If we need to get to a place in our own lives where we are so tuned in to the will and the plan of God in our lives that we are able to get in and to do what needs to be done, to be able to say, I have finished the race. Now, if you have not sought the will of God, you haven't pressed in to touch the hem of his garment, you haven't pressed in to find out exactly what your race is all about, it's going to be very difficult for you to do that. Now, we've got about 4 or 5 minutes left. If you have a Telegram group and you're one of our students, the Telegram group is open and you can now put down questions, and if you've got any or any comments or remarks. So, and then for those the students, sorry, those people that are watching and are not students, if you would like to become a student, all you need to go is to the GI Bible College website. You can enroll there and they will give you all the details necessary for you to become a full-time student. And then you'll have the right and the privilege to ask questions via Telegram. Right, so I see that one question has come through here from Sharon. She says, Pastor Les, if you are in a church that does not recognize your gifting or calling and does not activate gifts through laying on of hands and does not coach or develop your gifting, especially as a woman, how does one handle this and run your race? While respecting the church leadership, some churches only develop certain gifts in men. Sharon, here's the issue. You know, the thing is that this is the way I look at it. Time is limited. Christ is about to return. We don't have time to waste, all right? If you are in a church where they do not recognize women, they do not allow you to minister, they do not allow or create the opportunity for that, then maybe it's time for you to find a group of people that will embrace you for who you are and be able to embrace you and to allow that gift to flow freely and to be able to come to a place where you can live out that purpose that God has got in your life. And I do believe that's mostly partly why you are watching this particular thing and why you've joined this particular Bible school. It's because obviously you have a desire to unlock the gifts in you and to be able to fulfill that which Christ has called you to. So my you know, I don't have time to waste, and nor do you. And the thing is that when people try to limit others and not facilitate and help them to do what needs to be done in their lives and for Christ to live through them, then you've got to start asking yourself the question whether you are in the place that you should be. So my recommendation to you would be to go before the Lord, pray about it, say, Lord, is this a place I need to be? And then trust the Holy Spirit to show you, and then do what you need to do, you know, and so that you can enter into the fullness of what God has called you to do. Really, there's no time to waste. We don't have the luxury of just being able to casually sit by and just watch people go eternity, separated from Christ. That's just not on. You know, we've got to see as many people come into the kingdom as possible. Okay, so Rita Peterson, Apostle Liz, I'm still struggling to know what my calling is. So now I'm running a race with no direction but full trust. Is this wrong? No, it isn't, Sarita. You know what? The Bible makes a clear statement in Matthew chapter 16 and, Mark 16, Matthew 28. It gives very clear instruction what the Great Commission is. I always come back to that because the Great Commission is going to all world, preach the gospel, make disciples. Those are the two things just in a paraphrase. And you and I need to get people into the kingdom. That's number one. And number two, once they're in the kingdom, we need to make disciples of them. And that means teaching them and training them in the things of the Lord. So as we do that, you can't miss it because that's written in black and white. It's, you know, you look at the Bible, you read it, that's it. Okay. Now, where you and I fit into that equation or into that picture, that's debatable. All right. And that is obviously from person to person. And that's what we were talking about tonight. But I believe that as you embrace the bigger picture, as you start following that which Christ has said for you, you will start finding that the Holy Spirit will guide you, and suddenly doors will start opening and things will start happening around you because God sees the intent of your heart. He sees the desire of your heart, and He knows that you honor Him and you're committed to Him because you are. Your steps of the steps of a righteous man are ordered by God. So your steps will start being ordered by the Holy Spirit into that which is specifically for you. You need to just trust God and say, Lord, I believe that while I'm busy with your business that you've taught me in the Word, you will start showing me specifically for me what I need to do. And then start walking in that and enjoy it for what it is. Amen. All right, then Lorraine, I'm learning so much. We have been told that a lot of our gifting has to do with what we love doing or are passionate about. What happens now Are you going to figure out what your gifting is if you are passionate about so many things? Yeah, that could be a problem. You know, that's when also laying on of hands, men and women of God speaking prophetic words over your life, things like that. And it will crystallize out because, yes, you know, the thing is that God is amazing in the coloring and the stuff that He's put into our lives, because we have a situation where, you know, I look at myself and I can operate in a couple of ministry areas because God has been gracious to gift us in such. And there's many other preachers that do the same thing, and men and women of God that do the same thing. In other words, they can pastor and they can teach. They can evangelize and they can pastor and they can teach, etc. But there'll be one that will always come out stronger than the others. Now, the same thing with you. You're going to find that there's, of your likes and of your passions, there's going to be certain passions and likes that as you commit yourself to the Lord and as you walk your journey and walk your walk with God, your steps will also be ordered by God. And because your steps are being ordered by Him, you will find that there's certain things that will start materializing in your life. In the meantime, while you're waiting for that, you just do what the Word of God says do. Go out, win souls for the Lord Jesus. Number two, disciple them, coach them, mentor them, be there for them. And as you do that, you're going to see the hand of God operate in your life. And sooner or later, you'll fit into that niche. And before you know it, you'll be doing the things exactly that God has said before you. For those that are multi-skilled, multi-talented, and like many things, you know, I get jealous of those guys because I think God favors them. But God says He's got no favorites. So, you know, so bottom line is just enjoy your journey. Walk with Jesus and allow your passions to work out and God will direct your steps. Praise God. We have run out of time. In actual fact, we've gone over by 1 minute. So may the Lord bless you. Have an awesome evening as you get ready for Pastor Connie. We'll be on in about 10 minutes. Bless you guys.